यू सो मच बालाजी, एंड थैंक्स शारिफ एंड थैंक्स रेनबो लिट फेस्ट फॉर गिविंग मी द अपॉर्चुनिटी टू कंडक्ट दिस पैनल. इट्स अ क्वेश्चन वन कीप्स काइंड ऑफ एंगेजिंग विद, एंड आई थिंक वी नीड टू कीप एंगेजिंग विद इट इन द फ्यूचर एज वेल. वेरी सिंपल टॉपिक ऑन द फेस ऑफ इट, इन सर्च ऑफ एन आइडियल फिल्म. एंड आई वॉज जस्ट thinking it through, and I was thinking, how many layers could there be to it? You know, is there an ideal film? What defines it? Is it about representation, as Balaji was talking about, or is it about, appropriation? I think all these topics I'm going to discuss with my co-panelists, who are all people who I much respect and admire and have known for years now. Before we begin, just a bit of spelling out of the house rules. We will invite questions, and whoever would want to ask them could put them in the chat box at the bottom of the screen. So welcome everybody. Welcome Tanuja, Ghazal, Alankrita, Faraz. The search of an ideal film. I think I'll begin with the first question itself. Is there one? Is there any film that comes to your mind? Immediately when we talk of an ideal film. I think I'm just going to go a little micro before we can expand the argument into the macro zone. Any of you would want to think through and tell me some of the films of late which have kind of, if not been ideal, close to the ideal for you?
Oh, I mean, an ideal film in an absolutely unideal world. I doubt that's possible, because for me, actually, what a film that includes flaws and the flaws and frailties of human beings, and in fact our prejudices and our misconceptions should be included, because that would be a real film. To me, a real film would be an ideal film. And then, because to have a dialogue on these things is really important. To have representation, of course, is really important. And to speak about it and to speak about equality means necessarily to depict the inequality that exists in our world. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. To give you an example, please ask the others.
But tell me, Tanuja, when you were saying that ideal world, I mean, does ideal cinema, I mean, is it a factor of the world it is in? I mean, there can be no ideal film because there is no ideal world.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, there is a structure in films. There's no structure in life. So at least we have that in movies. There's a beginning, middle and end. There's a story that possibly has a resolution, and a non-resolution is also a resolution. But yes, it's not possible to have an ideal film. I think I forget who some great writer said that you don't ever really complete a script, you just abandon it. And then you have to make it at some time. Ghazal, who I've worked with a lot, it always comes down to that, now it's time to make the damn film.
Ghazal, would you consider an ideal film a work in progress rather than something that exists as an entity?
I kept mulling over this topic when I got. I was like, in search of an ideal film. I don't think there's one possible. It can exist in our minds. Like when we are planning a film, there is an ideal sort of imagination that you can have over film, I think. Because the things you want to say about humanity, about emotions, you come from a place of creating some sort of depiction of a perfect world that exists in your mind with all of its imperfections. But I don't think it completely ever translates, because you're not ideal. Your imagination is not ideal. You'll always fall short of perfection. Ideal is so subjective, right? Like my ideal would never be yours. It's a work in progress. I mean, the day we have an ideal world, the day we have a perfect world, which is never, will be probably have ideal films. And I don't think I'll have examples of ideal films. I can only have examples of my favorite films, which spoke to me, which I think spoke something about human existence, or even just even micro emotions at some level.
I'm going to come to Alankrita and Faraz. Faraz, let's ask you the definition for you, you know, of a ideal film, you know, which kind of does service to the community rather than the disservice that we often kind of talk about and you know, engage with and debate and kind of rant against also.
Thank you, Namrata. I personally think I don't believe in ideal. I don't believe in perfection. I believe in telling stories that come from the heart. I believe in honesty, and I feel that there is such beauty in honesty. You know, and honesty is never perfect. Honesty is flawed, like all of us, like the world that we live in. And I think one has to honor that. One has to accept it. One has to embrace it. So I would definitely... I was watching this wonderful film called Lady and the Tramp last night, Disney's live action adaptation of the original classic. And I absolutely loved it. I was thrilled. I was crying. I was cheering for the dogs. I was hating humanity, how stupid humans can be to abandon stray, you know, the stray is not looking after. And I really, it really resonated so deeply with me. I was up till 4 a.m. watching Lady and the Tramp, stupid. But, you know, I mean, that is an ideal film for me. I cried, I cheered, I loved it. And I feel that there is an ideal film in all the films that exist. You know, there is an ideal a story in all the stories that exist. And that's the beauty of it. How do you handle it is, I think, the part of representation that truly comes into play. You know, I mean, taking the conversation a little away when Balaji mentioned about representation, there is often this whole debate about meritocracy versus representation, you know, and which one should we go ahead with. I think it has to be a fine balance of both. You know, it has to be a bit of meritocracy and it has to be a bit of representation, and representation not just in front of the camera but also representation behind the camera, which often at times we miss talking about. You know, we don't really talk about that. We all only talk about do the actors belong to the LGBTQIA community, but it's not just limited to that. It's about the reason we have the queer films in the mainstream spectrum in India, which are so massively flawed, is because the team that is actually making them does not belong to the community. You know, they don't understand the sensitivities, they don't understand the portrayals, because they've not lived it. You know, they probably have researched on it and they are kind of leaning onto it through the borrowed wisdom and experiences, which is never the same, you know. And therefore, when you have a queer person behind the camera as well, you see the difference, you know. I mean, again, it really depends, because one of my all-time favorite films happens to be Brokeback Mountain, which was made by Ang Lee. And I don't think Ang Lee identifies as a part of the queer community. But, you know, it was written in, it existed as a part of literature, which was then, and again, I don't think any of the actors were a part of the queer community. But what the film did, it had great amount of sensitivity. Of course, if Brokeback Mountain was made in the times that we live in, I know many queer folks would be standing up saying that's not representation, you know, because there are not enough queer folks in it. And so I think that's okay, you know. I mean, it's okay to arrive late at a party, and it's okay to address issues when we get aware of them. So, you know, the people can call you woke or whatever, but I think it's important to address it when you get aware of it. And therefore, I feel that not just representation in front of the camera, but also representation behind the camera is equally important. And perhaps that can create an ideal film. You know, we have so many the queer stories being made, but they're not being made by queer people, you know, and therefore it'll never be ideal in that sense, because it lacks a personal journey. It lacks your personal narratives being put into, you know, the nuances. And that's always a miss, I feel.
Yeah, Faraz, you kind of preempted, a chunk of conversation, which I hope we kind of.
Oh God, always, always.
We will devote later as well. But to come to Alankrita, Alankrita, as a filmmaker, how far do you think we have traveled in terms of the representation of the, of the queer stories, of the queer experiences? Have we made any progress, if at all? Have we evolved at all? Or are we stuck at the same stage that we may have been a few years ago? Because, if we kind of look at the queer representation in cinema, it has been happening for quite a while, be it Bomb Gay, be it Fire, in its times. How far have we moved?
I think, to be very honest, we've not, from my perspective, I feel we've not moved very far. I think it's like maybe a few films, maybe a couple of films come out like every year, but I feel like we still have a very, very long way to go. I feel like maybe in the streaming space, we have perhaps moved forward a lot more. I think, I feel, for instance, a show like Made in Heaven really did put, the story of a gay man, like a little more on in the, in the forefront. But I feel vis-a-vis, there have been a few films. There was Margarita with a Straw, and there was a film that Ghazal wrote. So I just feel like there have been a few films, but I just still feel it's very tiny, I feel it would be really nice to have like many, many more films and many, many more stories. So I feel like it's moved a few inches, but it's not really, where I think it should ideally be. And of course, that's reflective of the society that we live in, because of the kind of orthodox mindset of society. So I feel it's so many factors, and one hopes that, the space keeps opening up. But I don't feel like we've really gone very far and things have changed a lot and all that. I think it's been very, very slow. It's encouraging that there are more stories now, but I just wish that, that there would be many, many more stories. And I think it's also not just about putting queer stories, films which are just about queer stories right in the center of the film or the show, but it's about what kind of universe do we depict. It may be like within a story, what are we showing? Are we showing some characters who are not, totally, straight and conforming? So I just feel it's like, the idea that we need to create a universe constantly in all our stories that is diverse. I think that's also very important. And I wanted to just add about this ideal film, because I found it such an interesting thing that this is like the topic. I just feel an ideal film is not equal to a perfect film. An ideal film is a film that moves you and makes you question things. And in that aspect, I feel there are so many ideal films. Like for instance, for me, Call Me By Your Name is an ideal film. It just moved me and it was so beautifully done. And, or like Monsoon Wedding many years ago. So I just feel like, there are many ideal films. They are not perfect films, but they just tell you something about the human experience. And I think if they make you think and feel, they've done their job.
Yeah, I'd just like to come in for a second. I totally agree with what Alankrita is saying. I guess, if you make the audience fall in love with a character or a situation that they have thus far disliked or had or resented, then that's a major step, I think, that a story or a film has achieved. To be moved, I think all storytelling is really for that purpose, and to create a better world. I mean, I think it's a waste of movie space if we are not using it to create a better world.
There are several strands that have suddenly struck me now that we've been talking. I'll try and pick them up one by one. First of all, Alankrita, you mentioned about the streaming world, the OTT world. And before we get into the complexity of representation, I am wondering, you know, when we talk of queer cinema, sometimes we don't look into some crucial, you know, technical, mechanical aspects of it, which is finance, which is production, which is exhibition, you know. I would want each of you to kind of tell me a bit about how these factors kind of come in the way, I mean, and how, or if not come in the way, actually help you realize as a artist what you want to portray on screen. So how crucial are these issues, you know, the finance, the production aspect, and the distribution and exhibition of queer cinema, and how does that impact what we get to watch on the screens?
Well, I think that it's very much an aspect of why we are not seeing enough cinema which doesn't toe the very mainstream line, because I feel like there is, it's a systemic problem in the system, because I feel this entire ecosystem of the film industry is designed to create, you know, the cisgender heterosexual male heroes, and the entire industry has been working around that. First you fund those films, you put a lot of marketing money, and then when you've created that male hero being the center stage of everything, and the male heterosexual hero being the center stage of everything, then everything, your entire economics is working around that. There's much more marketing there, exhibition works around that. So I feel all films that are slightly, which don't toe that line, have to kind of work around that system. And we don't have alternative systems of funding in India like in Europe, where there's any other way of funding. So it's very, very difficult. And it's not just queer cinema. I feel like even if it's, you know, cinema which is just different in terms of style, storytelling, or has a strong female narrative which is not headlined by a big female star, it's going to be, it's very, very difficult. And then of course there's censorship. So I think with queer cinema, that is also very, very prohibitive, because you know that, there are things that are not going to be passed. And then, so the financiers know that everybody knows that. So it keeps working backwards to kind of kill those stories before they can even kind of come to life. So I feel our system is not geared at all. Plus anyway, legally, we were not in earlier space. It was like, oh no, there'll be so much censorship. Even our laws are like that. So I just feel like there's definitely, in terms of industry, it's very, very prohibitive. And that's why I feel the streaming space has been a space where just like more is possible.
Mm-hmm. Tanuja, how do you skirt around it?
I have right from the start of my career, when my first film had a female protagonist, I had to take a well-known male star in order to get funding. And despite that, it had to be made in a medium to smallish budget, not in a big budget. So I have understood one thing. I've understood that the economics is what you have to be clever with. So make a film in a small budget. Alankrita will understand. She's been doing a lot of that. It frees you. It frees you of a lot of stuff. That, of course, doesn't guarantee exhibition, because exhibition is a whole extra sort of layer of spending money, you know. So there will be marketing will be done in a very small way. So you have to be innovative. You have to try and tie up with people. You have to try and get free sort of marketing done in any way possible. You have to try and get as many, you know, get a good weekend so you don't have too many competing big films along with you. So you have to, I mean, you know, you're working, or you're an outsider in a sense. And so you're working against the system. It can be done. I just think you have to doggedly be at it. And I think especially for queer, I mean, imagine a film with a queer protagonist. I think Faraz may have tried for many years and that's not been happening. So that we still have a long way to go. Like Alankrita was saying, that we have, you know, moved inches when there's really miles and miles to go. Mm-hmm. So just be at it. Just be at the crease and just be, you know, just make sure that you don't give up. Mm-hmm. And of course, thank goodness for OTT, right? Because we are all filling it up with queer characters liberally.
Ghazal, as a writer, how liberating have the OTT platforms been for you?
First, I just want to add one small bit to, you know, what Alankrita was saying, how this system has been created around a cisgendered male hero. What it also, you know, creates is this fear of fear in queer artists to come out as queer and hence be comfortable playing those queer characters. There's a dearth of actors who would be comfortable, you know, playing those, and forget queer. Matlab, for queer people to come out as queer is anyway a challenge, but because our storytelling is driven towards this, you know, really powerful, manly hero, there are no straight, very like rarely any straight actors who are also willing to play queer characters, which also then limits the, you know, the storytelling that you can do. And hence, there's less demand for those stories. So it's all centered in that very same seed of problem, which is that we have to tell cisgendered male stories. That's where it originates. OTT has been freeing. It's really been freeing. I don't know how long that's going to last, honestly, going by the recent news one has been hearing. Today it's possible for me when I'm pitching a story to a platform, to a streaming platform, it's possible to have a protagonist be queer. And to my surprise, I was genuinely surprised that there were no eyebrows raised. There was not even once an instruction given that, you know what, maybe make this character a supporting character, or maybe turn down their queerness, so to say. It was the most pleasant surprise. It's been really liberating. And my recent show, which came out, which is Mismatched, also has a very prominent character as queer. And it was just a beautiful experience to be able to create that universe in which that character can exist and can, you know, just be completely herself, have a 360 degree sort of personality around her, which is also a freedom that OTT gives you. You have episodes and episodes to write those characters, to have them breathe and, you know, live like three-dimensional lives. To be able to have that freedom for a queer character is unique, to be honest, for me as a writer. And it's just been wonderful to be able to do that. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Faraz, coming yes. to you, you know, you know, when we come to, you know, the OTT world, we come to the finance and production side. You as a filmmaker, tell us a bit about, you know, how have you faced up to all of this, you know, in your journey of making films, your own experience, like the ladies have shared.
So I personally, I mean, I've been trying to make a queer film with a queer protagonist, unabashed queer protagonist since 2014. And, you know, one still has many bridges to cross to make a mainstream queer film celebrating a queer protagonist, not selling it as a cishet romance, or not disguising it under the publicity of a cishet romance, or, you know, not talking about the elephant in the room, allowing the queer characters to talk for themselves rather than having the men talk about them, or, you know, other characters talk about them. So I think it is a task, and it is all the more of a task when you don't really want to give in. You don't want to give in to what they want you to do, right? I definitely understand the challenges that Bollywood sort of throws at you. You know, it is a curveball, and they want cishet protagonists. They want the Maryada Purushottam Ram to be leading, you know, every film, you know, and there has to be, you know, it's a very typical quintessential understanding of structure that one wants to put forward. But when you don't really want to give in and you don't want to go to the OTT route, because I personally want to make films that are mainstream, universal, wholesome that your family can sit down and watch together, and it happens to be a queer film, you know. There is no problem of it facing censorship or anything of that sort. So where does a filmmaker like me go? Because I'm not keen on OTT. I want the film to reach out to the masses. So I think one has to find other alternative routes. And when I say other alternative routes, I think one of the most important things that I have discovered is you need to look outside of India to begin with. You know, I mean, India is not just the epicenter of filmmaking. There is great filmmaking happening across the globe, you know, and some really progressive filmmaking, unlike what we've been doing in India, in at back home. And therefore, I mean, I've been very particular of what I've making. So after I made Assisak, and Assisak traveled to about 250 film festivals, it won over 59 international awards. But back home, no one was really talking about Assisak. Nobody really wanted to, you know, talk about it. And I understand why as well. The next film that I made is called Sheer Korma. Here's a very interesting story that I have of Sheer Korma. So when I wrote Sheer Korma, it has a queer Muslim protagonist, and it has a non-binary protagonist who's also comes from a Muslim family. And when I reached out to a person who was very keen on financing my next film after watching Sisak, and they turned around, I narrated the whole film to them, and they were like, this is a great story, but can you make these two people into men? And can you change their Muslim family into, you know, let's just keep it like a Hindu family. So it's not just about, I think, the queer representation. It's so much more than queer representation, right? It's about telling authentic stories. This particular producer didn't want to see queer women. They didn't want to see a non-binary character. They said, "Wo kya hai? What is non-binary? Ye aur aap logo ko aur confuse kyun kar rahe ho? Ye sab introduce karke." And then, of course, there was the whole stigma of Islam. You know, they were like, "Don't mix gender and faith together, because, you know, thin ice, you're going to fall through it." So I think one is constantly facing challenges, but at no point of time does that really hold me back from telling the stories that I want to. You know, I understand the privilege that it takes to be able to say that, you know, because I have a family, I have a home to live, and, you know, I don't have to live from one check to the other check. So, you know, I can wait, I can do it the right way. But I understand that reality does not exist for, many folks who are working tirelessly to create content. I don't create content for the heck of it. I don't create content for OTT and so on and so forth. I create content that I believe in, and that I genuinely feel will change lives. You know, I saw lives changing with a short film like Sisak, which is just 20 minutes. You know, I saw people come out to their families when Sheer Korma's trailer was launched earlier this year. I still have people coming out to their families after watching a 2-minute trailer. So I understand the power that cinema has is truly transformative. It can really, truly change lives. So I feel one has to look for alternatives in terms of when it comes to seeking funding or seeking exhibition, not just look at India as the be all and end all of things. I think there are great funds that exist internationally. There are great grants that exist internationally for QPOCs, for the people of the color. And I think if we can start tapping into those, we can probably still make authentic stories just the way we want to, without censoring ourselves or saying, "Nahi, yahan par to aisa hi hota hai, to aisa hi karna chahiye." You know, I think that those are just excuses that we make up for ourselves, because we don't push ourselves harder.
Yeah, but so, tell me, Paraz, isn't it a kind of a double-edged sword also somewhere that, you know, you choose to be the alternatives, then isn't there a danger of the narrative then remaining on the margin? You know, I mean, I just find myself grappling with that kind of a dichotomy that, you know, is it more important to make inroads into, mainstream, because then you kind of, you know, or just function at the margins? Wouldn't that also then force you to stay there, or do you see it as any different?
I actually agree to you, that's the whole point that I've been also trying to make, that I don't believe in the margins at all. I believe in wholesome mainstream content, you know, and I feel if you're not getting enough support from the mainstream makers that exist in this country, then you reach out to mainstream makers outside this country. Like Alankita said, in Europe, you know, there are great funds that are available in North America and Canada. You know, there are great people who are doing great mainstream content, which is celebrating journeys and celebrating people, and that is mainstream, and that is perhaps a bigger mainstream, you know, than just the Indian mainstream that we are so used to. And I feel that when you start making content which is more international, it will percolate back home, you know, eventually it will reach here and it will be celebrated. And it's really sad and sick of us that, you know, we generally end up celebrating content which is really applauded in the West, and then, you know, we kind of don't value it while it exists at home, but when it goes international and it, you know, gets applauded, then we kind of wake up to it and we're like, oh, I think we should applaud it too now. So I feel definitely, I mean, I always make films for my mother. My mother loves watching Guide and Vizara on repeat, you know. So my mother is my quintessential target audience. I make films for her. And I feel if I'm making a queer film for my mother who watches Vizara and Guide and Pakiza and all these lovely films, it will be mainstream by default, you know. The challenge lies in how to find the right producer to support it, you know. And I think it's the possible, because with Sheer Korma, eventually I did find a producer, Marika D'Souza, and this happens to be her first independent film as a producer. You know, she's been working with Dharma for all her life as a producer, so she sees how important it is to make wholesome mainstream content, which is also the queer. And therefore, we have a Sheer Korma that exists. So, you know, I think it's all about, like Tanuja also mentioned, sticking around and, you know, trying to push and trying to nudge and saying, hey, I'm here, you know, you cannot like shut the spotlight on me. I'm going to be here and I'm going to keep pushing and I'm going to keep trying to make the content with representation, not just in front, but also behind the camera.
Which means each one of you has, an own strategy, so to, say to move forward. Sheer Korma, you mentioned about, there are three things that are there. You know, one is the queer representation, there is the Muslim representation, and then the women, you know. Now, I have also...
I am minority cube.
But I kind of want to expand that into, you know, a zone where I find that increasingly, and when one looks at especially films from abroad, intersectionality is, you know, a big, big thing. You know, it's not, I mean, experiences of people on the margins are somehow coming together rather than, becoming standalone or getting divergent. And, you know, interestingly, Alankrita, you had spoken about the universe, if you go back to what we were talking about, that a fuller universe so that the queer characters also become full, in their own way. Is it important to kind of do this consciously, to kind of have this coming together, so to speak, you know, of issues, whether they are to do with sexuality, class, caste, gender, wherever there is this effort to push you into the margins, to bring all of that into the focus. Can it be done consciously? I mean, I'd like to put this to Tanuja, you, Alankrita, and Ghazal, you know, all of you, you know.
Sorry, can I just add one point, Amrita? I feel, there's a difference between intersectionality and tokenism. Mm-hmm. And I think tokenism is very visible, which happens in most Indian content. You know, there is a queer character for the heck of it. There is a queer narrative for the heck of it. You know, it's not really complementing your main story, or it's not really adding to anything else. It's just pure tokenism. And I feel tokenism is exhausting. You know, I mean, I don't have time for it. I don't have time for tokenism. I have time for intersectionality, because that needs to be addressed. That needs to be talked about. But
yeah, there is strength in, you know, somewhere in coming together. My intent was not to bring out the tokenism part of it, but if it could be done in a more thought through and you know, more complex way, for the lack of a better word, you know, how do you tackle that, Alankrita? Do you see merit in that?
Yeah, definitely. I feel, feel like there is a kind of connection also between intersectionality and also having a universe where you see, two different identities of a person, which it's not just about one thing. And I really do feel that, you know, often it's not just about one thing, because you are never just one aspect of your identity. You are also, you know, which caste you belong to, which religion you belong to, what's your economic status, what's your sexuality. I just feel all of these things, you know, there's a kaleidoscope of these things that make us, who we are. So I think it is interesting to have that lens of being able to see characters and stories, you know, where you see for me, I find it interesting to see often intersectionality, for instance, of class and economic need, with gender, for instance. So I do think that there is a lot, which is like in Lipstick, I felt like there was a thing of religious and social and cultural norms intersecting with gender issues. In Dolly Kitty, I did feel like this thing of, you know, like they did, even though it was not stated, but they did belong to a particular caste. And then, of course, there's a particular strata and you see that intersecting. And there's also other stories like what happens to Dolly's son. Similarly, in Made in Heaven also, I felt like we did, you know, like one of the main protagonists is gay, but the story is not just about him being gay, but, you know, you also see it's like a critique of patriarchy in various ways and examining marriage and other issues. So I do feel there is a beauty and there is something, you know, about things coming together, because I feel that people or society, it's never just one thing. You know, I feel like so many things are affecting us and shaping, who we are. So I think there is, and I think we should actually, as filmmakers and writers, I think we should work harder to find those, those nuances and those crevices where things sort of intersect. Like, I feel it's done really beautifully in the show I May Destroy You, you know, this British show. And it's just so beautiful because you see like how so many things, end up shaping who we are, making us take certain decisions. They explain how society is treating us, how we are interacting with society. So I definitely feel there's a lot to be done in this aspect of intersectionality. I think that sometimes it's instinctive, but once it emerges in a story, I think definitely one can, take a step back and, just look at it. I am not very much in favor of force fitting things. I feel it should come organically from the story that you're trying to tell, rather than, pasting things on top. I'm not very much in favor of that, but definitely I feel the idea of creating more diverse universes in whatever story you're telling, would be amazing. I think it'd be amazing if in India, there was a big action film and the main protagonist was gay. We have never had that, why should it be that, so I just feel like that, I think, would be really like what Faraz is saying. It's in the mainstream, but it's like everybody can watch it. But it's just, so I just feel we have a very, very long way to go, before we can. But I think it's good that conversations are starting. And I think it's great if people start thinking about these things.
Mm-hmm. Ghazal, the element of tokenism, the fact that, a lot of the queer characters end up being supporting rather than, the lead characters. How does one set that balance correct? And on top of that, we were talking about intersectionality and a larger universe, As a writer, where do you place yourself in that? And where do your characters come from?
What Faraz was talking about, there is an idealism in that which I appreciate. But I think fact for me is also that stories need to exist. There has to be exhibition of stories so that they stay in people's mind space, I think even if it's supporting characters, if that is a conduit you can find to bring out those stories as a part of a mainstream, which is maybe not centrally, the story is not about that supporting queer character, but you're keeping that queer character visible. They become a part of the mind space of the viewer. Like I was talking about Mismatched, in which the queer character is a very prominent secondary character, but you may think it's not about her, but by the end of the show, everything comes crashing down because of her. She actually becomes the central conflict of the show. And you may not enter the show thinking that. So I think just like that in Ek Ladki Ko Dekha as well, just the creation of the character came with intersectionality. It was a queer, it was a gay girl in a patriarchal society, in a small town. I think there was just those dimensions created a very interesting character by itself. And then there was, you know, that allowed for intersectionality in other characters around her. For example, her father, who is himself part of that patriarchal society and is himself judging her, actually loves to cook. And his mom is against him cooking because she thinks it's the job of a woman. I think creating characters like that within mainstream, when, you know, your viewer is going to watch that popular song and dance number, which, you know, they've heard play on YouTube, they're going to watch that. But within that, you're putting in this character who they're going to laugh at. They're going to find it funny that, oh, you know, the mom pulls his legs for being womanly. Yes, you're giving your viewer entertainment, but I think subconsciously you're planting a seed of starting to become okay with these challenging ideas of whether it's queer culture or it's about a man being less, you know, manly in an orthodox way. So yeah, I think the bottom line that I'm trying to say after all this meandering is that it's important to tell stories. It's important even if your actor is not queer. I'm saying even if the person behind the camera is not queer, but they're doing it with a really honest intention of telling a story which makes a difference, I think it's important that those stories are out there. Tanuja directed this film that I wrote, which was A Monsoon Date, which had Konkona playing a trans character. Just the fact that Konkona was ready to play that got us funding. You know, we were able to make that film because a star like her was willing to play that character. And that allowed us to have that film out there, reach out to many people and tell that story. So I would always stand for, at least as of right now, we're in a very nascent stage of telling queer stories. So right now it's important to tell those stories, however you do it.
So yes, please let me.
Of course, I was coming to you. You know, I was coming to you because the question of appropriation, which you know is appropriation of stories, appropriation of space, appropriation of even the actors. Because yesterday, I think Onir was talking about Porushpur and Milind Soman playing a trans character, if I'm not mistaken. I don't know much about the film. And I think he was saying about when will the third gender be allowed to perform as third gender, you know. And I also was thinking about this whole controversy around Scarlett Johansson, you know, how she had to pull back. And then you have a character, an actor like, Daniela Vega, who gets to play a fantastic, woman. So it's a complicated issue, this whole appropriation. Tanuja, I'll start begin with you taking it forward and then come to Faraz on it,
So I want to take what Ghazal said. I completely agree with everything she said, and I want to take that to an extreme. I'm of an activist, aggressively revolutionary mindset. I say by any means possible. You have one what we call abrasive female character, or you have a queer character for one scene. I think that's important. I don't consider that tokenism. And if that is tokenism, I welcome it. Why? Because it's just you're slowly just bringing it all into the system. And you're acquainting people, including myself. Let me not be some high priestess of, you know, of knowing queer people. I do know them, and I've intimately been close to many queer people. I'm a heterosexual, but I think that that by any means possible, by even half knowledge, by half experience, by zero experience, your intention in itself indicates to me a kind of a move forward, you know. And so I say by any means forward, by any means that we can bring in speaking about an equal world, the whole, and denounce and dispute the fact that people call it unnatural, because nature does not discriminate. Nature has just about every kind of sort of organism and animal and insect and your shapes and sizes and colors that you can imagine. So you know, I would like to start by denouncing the very basic prejudice that exists, that homosexuality is unnatural. It is not unnatural in the least. And if I can say this even in one dialogue in a film, I'd be happy to do it. But the idea is that one must do it. So therefore, when the question came of whether I want to make what Ghazal was speaking about, one of my special films in my life, A Monsoon Date with Konkana, or wait for a trans actor to be able to bring the kind of performance she did, I'd rather go ahead and make it, put the movie out there, have people speak about it, have people moved by it, have people who are ideologically against, say, a trans person, suddenly find themselves levitating towards her, find affection for her, find warmth for her, find even the somewhere in their minds the ability to say that maybe she should be allowed to be what she truly feels. You know, if she was feeling trapped in a male body, maybe it really isn't so wrong what she did. That's to me a reward. It's a huge reward. So yeah, so I say activism.
Okay. Faraz, where do you come into the, I mean, and how do you come into this this debate? Before I kind of move on to audience questions, we may be running out of time, but I would want you to kind of weigh in on this before I start taking the audience questions.
You know, Namrata, I recently wrote an article on allyship and what it means to be a true ally. You know, I think the first rule of being a true ally is to step out of the spotlight if you don't belong to that community and allow people from the community to tell their stories in their way. You know, I think being an ally is to create opportunities, create platforms for the underrepresented communities to tell the stories the way they want to, rather than taking, you know, the opportunity away from them, rather than taking the platform away from them. Just to speak out of personal experience, since I have been very vocal about my sexuality and my gender identity, I keep losing out on a great deal of mainstream work, you know. And when mainstream work goes the queer way, it often does not end up coming to an openly queer filmmaker, you know. It ends up going the other way, or it ends up going saying, oh, we have a bigger name who's a bigger director than you are, because they've made 3 films. Whether they're successful or not, that doesn't matter, but they've made 3 films. So, you know, we'll go to them and we'll get them to do it. And when you say, but hey, but that person is not even the queer, they're like, yeah, but you know, that's a bigger name. So I think when that happens, I think it's pretty upsetting, because, you know, you've been really trying to push for authentic storytelling, authentic representation, and when that does not really come full circle, it just feels defeatist in many ways. And you know, like you mentioned, Daniela Vega being a part of, you know, a fantastic woman, when you have a trans person playing a trans character, it will win the Academy Award, you know, because there is authentic representation which will be applauded, not just back home, but also internationally. Because let's be honest, we are living in a different world. We're not living in, you know, say even 2 years back, things were very different. You know, people were not talking about trans rights and so on and so forth. And not just about trans rights, but I think also about the queer representation. And I think without ruffling feathers, I genuinely feel that if you have to be a true ally, you need to be able to know when to step out of the spotlight to allow the queer people to tell our stories the way we want to, you know. I genuinely feel that when that happens, there will be a true change. You know, what we talk about, an ideal film will come by when we allow the right people to step in, you know, and to tell the stories the way we want to. And you see the difference, you know. I mean, when I see a queer film made by a queer person, it feels different than seeing a queer film made by someone who does not belong to the queer spectrum, you know. The same way when it comes to writing. Of course, there are sellouts here and there are sellouts there as well. But I think if one really sticks around long enough and has faith that, you know, the believing that right representation will truly change the path of the future of cinema. And I don't just mean Indian cinema. I think I mean cinema in general, you know. I think then things will start changing. I do get a lot of, you know, when I talk about representation, I do get a lot of back flack by people saying that, hey, but you made Cheer Korma and you have Divya Datta and you have Swara Bhaskar in it. You know, how, what are you talking about representation? But what a lot of people don't know that actually in Cheer Korma, I have a trans woman who's playing the role of a cishet woman in the film, you know. And I feel that's how you extend representation, that's how you extend inclusion, you know, because I truly believe a trans woman is a woman and a trans man is a man. I thoroughly believe in that. So I think we need to practice a little bit more of what we believe in and, you know, push ourselves a little harder and, you know, not give in to, you know, the pressures of the cishet world around us, which is forcing us to cast cishet people for queer characters or trans characters. I mean, I don't know Divya's sexuality. I don't know Divya's gender identity. I don't know Swara's gender identity and sexuality. I've never asked them. I reached out to them as actors and, you know, so they are in my film. But I think it's a total different case when you're dealing with a trans character. I mean, I wrote a feature film which has a trans protagonist. I was supposed to make it in 2018. I started the casting for it, but the role is so particular, it being of a trans woman in their late 50s and being of Parsi descent and origin, that I'm yet to find an actor who fits the bill. And therefore, I have decided to wait until I find the right character to play that film. I started doing free acting workshops for the trans community in Delhi and in Bombay. We've had over 600 trans the participants from across the community who've come from across the country to participate in these acting workshops, which have been, you know, we've had the Kalki to come and hold sessions. We've had Divya, we've had Swara come hold sessions. We've had casting directors come host sessions like Tess Joseph and Mukesh Chhabra's company and all these people. And I think you work in inclusion in various different ways, you know, when you cannot find.
Yeah, I can imagine that, because I think all of you are chipping away at the you know, this whole monolith or a structure that kind of gets created, and doing your own bits. And much as I have very many questions about the whole process to ask, you know, to each of you, I'm finding all your arguments equally persuasive, you know, and it's not either or situation here. But I'm going to quickly move into the audience questions, lest we be kind of thrown out of this, you know, Zoom session. There is one question which the first question from the audience is about, does fire not fall into representation by people who don't understand what they are depicting? How do you balance that with the acclaim it has received? You know, again, I think goes back to the appropriation debate. I, any of you would want to take this question?
Well, I think,
I
just want to say that it, you know, both these can and should coexist. It's important to tell stories just like Paya did. And it made a huge difference to our cinema, to the lives of queer people. And it's also important to encourage queer artists so that they're able to tell their own stories. But I'm saying it's intersectional. You know, the thing is that the more stories you tell of queer people, the more courage queer artists will also get. They'll also feel more free that to be able to tell their own stories, which is why I think that visibility is really important. It's important to keep telling those stories. Yes, wait out for that perfect character, for that perfect actor, yes. But there also has to be some urgency to telling these stories, because time is going by. And if I'm gonna get a Sonam Kapoor Ahuja to play a gay character, which will ensure that I get a certain budget and this film will reach out across the world to a lot of people because it has Punjabi song and dance that people can dance at weddings to, I think it should be made. I think that film should be made rather than waiting for the time when waiting forever for a time when a queer actor is as popular and will be able to get as much audience in as Sonam would in today's times. So I think it's parallel. It needs to coexist. Both the arguments are valid. I'm not saying what Faraz is saying. There's a lot of purity of intention in that, which I really appreciate. Which is why I think queer stories and queer artists are both important. And they need not always overlap, is what I'm saying.
So Namrata, just to add to that, I would like to, you know, I mean, I definitely agree to what Ghazal says, you know, especially when it comes to that she managed to get Sonam to be a part of Ek Ladki, and that got the budget and that got great, you know, a great scale to tell a queer a story on. But my point that I've been trying to make is that I think it's totally cool to get, you know, a non-queer person to play a queer character if it's going to really help the narrative go forward. But then I feel, how do you balance representation, you know? Then get a queer person behind the camera, you know? Get a queer team behind the camera to make sure that the story is being treated the right way. And it's not just, you know, cis in front of camera, cis behind the camera, but you're trying to tell a queer tale, you know? That is my problem, that how do you balance it out? I think balance in terms of coexistence, like Ghazal rightly said, is important. That is what coexistence is about, and I think that is what inclusion is about. You have to be inclusive and you have to weigh your pros and cons. You know, if you're not being inclusive in front of the camera, then be inclusive behind the camera. So balance it out. I think that is an essential point that we often miss talking about when it comes to queer representation. It's only limited to what's happening in front, but it's never, nobody turns around and sees what's going behind the scenes, which is way more important, I feel, many times.
Which brings me to this question here, which says that, can you give an example of how storytelling changes when the story is by a queer person? That's quite a technical thing also. And accompanying that is another question very focused on writing, which says that queer characters are often presented as sources of humor, which we've often debated about the slapstick, the, you know, but so does the element of humor do, you know, does disservice to queer representation, or is there a space to negotiate with humor towards more positive outcomes? Yeah.
You know,
Tanuja, please go ahead.
No, I was just saying that I think both things can happen. I mean, I remember Bend It Like Beckham. Mm-hmm. It had just that one supporting character who turned out to be gay. And I loved it. I mean, I think through comedy, there is a lot that you can get away with. And I think one must make use of that. Because often if in a serious film, you're going to make very strident sort of commentary and statements, you might find resistance to them. But comedy lets you just get into the hearts of people because, you know, because they're feeling so happy, they're laughing, they're feeling good about it, and they end up just loving that character. And so you've kind of won the round, you know. So I think while I do not, cannot stand, you know, caricaturish representations of either women or even of Muslim characters or of queer characters, comedy has a lot of value and has a lot to contribute to our ability to say things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just want to add that, you know, I think there's a difference between laughing along with the characters, where there is no disrespect, but I think it's very problematic when we put queer characters and we, you know, make them like the objects of object of jokes. I think that is problematic. And to be very honest, personally, I feel that, I mean, just as a viewer, I feel that definitely does more disservice than service. I feel like the moment I feel like when that humanity is not there towards that character, I feel it takes away more than it can add. Then you may as well not have those characters, is what I feel. And I think this is a typical trope of mainstream cinema, whether they do that with people who are fat or like, oh, you know, sometimes. So I just feel I find it problematic because I feel then don't have them. You know, if you're going to just use them to, because then I feel what it ends up doing is solidifying stereotypes rather than, and you know, like strengthening the kind of biases that people have rather than dismantling them. So I think that for me, that is very, very problematic. And I feel it's not adding any value. Just having them then laugh and making audiences laugh at them is then don't have them, is what I personally feel. Mm-hmm.
Ghazal, this other question, you know, how does the storytelling change when the story is by a queer person?
Does the storytelling change?
Does it change? I
It certainly changes. I mean, there is certainly a dimension, a lived dimension to it, which, let's say, I'm going to take the example of the other mainstream Hindi film, which dealt with queer protagonists, which is Shubh Mangal Zyada Savdhan, I think, which came this year.
Yeah.
I believe, to my knowledge, the team behind the camera is also not queer. The film did get a lot of attention, and I know from the queer community, there's plenty gay friends of mine who had a great time watching it. They felt represented. But there were also enough people who thought that, you know, it was sort of upar upar se. Matlab, there was, yes, all the things it was saying was absolutely right, and that's important. Which is why that film should have been made, and I'm happy it got made. But the presence of, say, a queer person behind the camera could have brought some nuances to it, some more like heartwarming quality within the same, you know, universe, within the same amount of humor and song and dance and all of that, and all the mainstream characteristics. But yeah, it certainly helps a lot. I agree with Faraz on that. It definitely helps a lot. And yet, I would give all credit to Hitesh that, you know, he really worked very hard on that script. I know Hitesh, the writer and director. And if I were to contribute to that script, I would have done some things differently. But to not take any credit away from him for making that film. I'm glad he did.
Just one second. Balaji, do we have time for more questions or should we...
Balaji, you're on mute.
Actually, we are running out of time. I know this discussion is going really, really nice, but of course, we have other next set of panelists waiting. So yes, I think we can sum it up if you guys allow me to.
Please do. My apologies to all the participants whose questions I was not able to include in this discussion. But sorry, I think we just got into the flow of conversation and maybe we can carry it forward another time, another place. Thank you so much, all of you, for being part of this. Balaji, please take over from here.
Yes. To sum it up, of course, I would completely go with Alankrita over here. I was just listening to her. She says an ideal film is a film, of course, which moves you. It's not about having a perfect film at the end of the day. And what I feel is maybe we can talk about the representation of lived realities from the community and maybe, of course, you know, people from the community, which would again be very diverse and of course different stories and narratives, which could of course be having different emotions from the spectrum, like sad and happy and so on. And that's what I feel, and correct me if I'm wrong. So yeah, with this, of course, we come to the end of our first panel discussion for day two. And thank you so, so much before I call it off. Thank you so much, Tanuja Chandra. Thank you so much, Ghazal. Thank you so much, Alankrita, Faraz and Namrata Joshi for giving your precious time to us. And hopefully we get to meet you all someday. Yes. So yeah, thank you. Thank you so much and have a lovely day. Thank you so much. Thank you.